I would love to just say that so many people have asked me where I've learned like how to set boundaries. And I think the majority of my education honestly has come from you. That's why I'm excited to introduce you to the community, because you've taught me so much about being able to set limits and that it's okay to set limits. So everybody, this is my husband, Ryan. A lot of you have met him in the DMs already. But yeah, so we're gonna answer some of your boundary questions together.
All right, boundary question number one. So this one's pretty fun, I think, but it's not fun if you're in the situation. So okay. Mom and stepdad wants to come on our honeymoon cruise. What do we do?
No, absolutely not.
Yeah, I would say the same thing. My initial gut instinct is just immediately no. For one thing, that morning after breakfast, that would be very awkward. Let's say my mother-in-law looks across the table from me and she says, so how was last night? What'd you guys do? I mean, right there, that's enough to just say, Nah, they can't come.
But now that we know that that is our hard pass, I want to put ourselves in the mom's shoes, because it's her mom, right? Asking to join. Why on earth would she ask? So let's try to understand where she's coming from. Because as a mom, I could never imagine asking Allie or James if we could join them. I wonder if like they're super enmeshed and she just thinks like they should be a part of it. I wonder if she never got a honeymoon and this is her way of kind of living vicariously through her daughter. I wonder if they are honeymooning in a place that's on her bucket list. Like, let's say she really wants to go on this cruise and she always wanted to, and here she thinks it's her chance. You know, so I'm trying to also put some understanding on the mom's point of view.
Yeah, and I think that's your real strength. Like, I'm more the person that just sets the boundary, honestly, like more thinking about like my own needs.
Yeah.
But that's your strength, is you put yourself in the other person's shoes. And I think that helps a lot. So like all the situations you laid out, they're all possibilities, and it's good to do that. But I would still, like, if this was me, like, I would still have to set the boundary that my mom and my stepdad aren't going to come on this honeymoon cruise.
So then like a possible script she could say to her mom that would be kind, but yet very, very clear. I would say, Mom, you know, Brett and I, we're going to be doing the honeymoon cruise by ourselves because it's just our one time chance to do this together. And let's say she's worried that the mom is going to be truly offended. So let's say she's worried about that and she is close to her mom. I would then extend an alternative by saying, but how about we plan something in the future where us four can get together and go do something? It doesn't have to be a cruise, an actual trip where you have to take time off work. It can be a day trip, like to someplace that she also wants to visit, like a lighthouse nearby or a candy shop, whatever. But I would just say, we're going to do this because it's just for us. We really want to experience this, just the two of us. But I would really love to plan something in the future where the four of us can go and enjoy each other.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. Because it's like an ace up your sleeve, just depending on how she reacts. It's not like you're obligated to give something because you're setting a boundary.
True.
You want to spend time with your mom and your stepdad. You just don't want it to be on your honeymoon cruise. So as you set the boundary, like, you're giving them something in return as well, which it's just nice.
It would make me feel better by extending something like that, because it would make her feel less rejected or even less silly for even asking in the first place. Because I don't want her to feel stupid for asking to join me on my honeymoon.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I think it would just kind of like land softer.
You just have to set the boundary and then maybe have that ace up your sleeve to soften the blow that they're not going to come on your honeymoon cruise.
What's the next question?
All right. Question number two coming at you. How do I stop feeling guilty after boundary setting when mother-in-law is upset? So broader, I would just say, like, how do I stop feeling guilty around boundary setting?
Yeah. And that is, I think, the number one reason why people don't set a boundary, because of that discomfort. And so the first thing I want to tell you is that the discomfort does pass. Like, you do learn ways and tools to like cope and go through the discomfort, like get through that. The one thing I try to do is I try to remind myself in the moment, why am I even setting this boundary? Like, I'm setting this boundary either to protect a value, to protect time, and also to protect my relationship with my mother-in-law. So I remind myself why I set the boundary. That helps my guilt. And then I get busy. Like, I'll go for a walk. I'll do something productive. I don't allow myself to ruminate. Because in my earlier days when I didn't set boundaries, that's what prevented me from setting boundaries, is because I thought that discomfort would never go away.
I was doing a little bit of research on common questions around boundaries.
Yeah.
And actually, the number one question around boundary setting is, how do I not feel guilty about setting boundaries? So this is the number one question.
Yeah. And in feeling guilty, I think it's just like feeling hungry. I think it's a natural thing that happens to us because we don't want to disappoint people. We don't want to feel rejected. We don't want, whether it's family members or even our community. We don't want to be rejected from the tribe. And so I believe it is a natural intrinsic feeling that comes up to keep us bonded with each other because we don't want to let anyone down. And we have to know that it passes.
Yeah, I think if you care about the person that you're setting boundaries with, that's why it feels guilty. Like a stranger on the bus or something like that, where you say like, you know, get off my lap. Like, you're not going to sit on my lap. You're not going to feel guilty about that. You don't know them. You don't feel bad about it.
Yeah.
But, you know, you might feel guilty about saying that to somebody that you care about.
Yeah.
It's just like, it's just that type of dynamic.
Like if your 12-year-old son has a growth spurt and now they're sitting on your lap and they're hurting you, you'd just be like, dude, you can't sit on mom's lap anymore. And then you see their face and there's like, oh, I'm sad. You feel bad.
So you gave some good, I would say, like in the moment, short-term coping mechanisms for the guilt of setting a boundary. I'd like to go long-term, like helping the person that you're setting the boundary with, helping them understand what a boundary is, why you're doing it, and how it actually helps their relationship in the long-term. So it's, you're educating them on boundaries because not everybody's familiar with that. I'd say most people aren't familiar with what a boundary really is all about.
No.
So if you change that person's outlook, they're going to start thinking that, okay, this isn't a bad thing. This is a positive thing. She's doing it or he's doing it to me because they want the relationship to be better and more positive.
Yeah.
And I just think in my head, you know, if you're doing something positive and you know that the other person knows that, it's hard to feel guilty about that.
So to kind of summarize it, I'm saying first, guilt is totally normal. Guilt, and you said 100%. Guilt means you care. Yeah, guilt means you care. The second thing, remember that why you set the boundary in the first place. So coming back to like just the basics, like why did I even need this boundary? So remind yourself of that and then get busy doing something. So don't just sit and ruminate with the guilt. And you're saying expand it even bigger by just educating our loved ones so that they understand why you're doing it and that it's actually strengthening the relationship.
Yep. I think that's the best way to go about it.
What's the next question?
Question number three, how do I compromise on a boundary that to me is essential?
You do not.
Right. At the current time, the definition of essential is that you need it. You're not going to compromise on a boundary that's essential because if you start to compromise, the person is going to start to let themselves in more often because you compromise once, they're going to think it's okay next time. And you can't really be wishy-washy with something that's essential.
And that is one of the top boundary setting mistakes is not being consistent. If it's essential, you have to stay consistent. Otherwise, the other person is going to be very confused.
Yes, 100%. Because they're not going to know, is it okay this time? Is it not okay this time? And I don't really think that looks good on your part anyways. Like it does make you look indecisive. To me, it just makes them take the boundary less seriously.
I believe it really hurts the relationship because it is because you're building resentment. They're confused. They don't know what the heck's going on because sometimes it's important, sometimes it's not. And it, I think it does a lot of damage.
So you don't compromise on a boundary that's essential to you because essential means that you need it. But it doesn't have to stay in your life forever.
Yes. A lot of our boundaries do evolve with us. I mean, just think of what you needed in, you know, when your babies are really young versus what you need now as they're growing up or what you need when you're first starting out in a career versus now. Everything just kind of evolves. Or maybe even with parents aging, you're going to have different boundaries around just time and work. You're going to need different things throughout your life. It's seasons.
All right. And seasons change.
Seasons change.
All right. Next one.
Yes. I think we should do it. Do you have the heat on? I'm going to faint in here.
Yeah, I do. You can turn it down. All right. I would say this is a boundary setting classic.
Okay.
How to handle in-laws that constantly come by unannounced, and they even made a copy of our key when we were away without asking.
Oh my gosh.
So they were letting themselves in the house and we've since changed the locks.
That's perfect. That's the first step is changing the locks.
Right. This is a classic question though, right?
It is. So many people ask about unannounced visits. So you have to have a script like rehearsed and you have to say it. So I would say, oh, Barb and Bill, I wish you would have called first. We're not up for guests. Let's set up something for later this week.
You know, it's uncomfortable at first, but like you said, really holding it makes all the difference. Because when I thought about this in my head, what came to mind was like you're going to a store and stores have open and closed hours, right? If you go to a store without looking at their hours beforehand and you show up and those doors are locked and it's closed, what are you going to do the next time? Going to check the hours the next time you go to that store. So you're no longer coming by, you know, unannounced. You actually change your behavior. And that's exactly what you're going to do when your parents or your in-laws come to the door unannounced. And you essentially say, sorry, like the store is closed right now. Please come back later.
Yeah. Yeah. You're absolutely right. And that leads me to think that if they're still showing up unannounced, and this is like a consistent problem over a long period of time, that means that you are probably not minding your boundary. Like, you're letting them come in. Like, you still feel guilty, like, oh, they showed up unannounced, but they're here already. Come on in, Barb and Bill. But that you're giving them that reward. That would be like the store owner, like, still rummaging around in the back and opening the door for you and letting you in. You would still come at all hours because the store owner compromised.
Yeah, but guess what? The store owner resents you. Like, he doesn't actually want you there. Like, he's mad at you for being there, but he still lets you in because it's like the polite thing to do.
Yeah.
But if you kept doing that, like, eventually, like, he would blow up on you. Something bad would happen. Mm-hmm. He would continue to resent you, and the relationship would not be positive, be getting more and more negative over time. So yeah, it's uncomfortable to say, sorry, the store is closed, mm-hmm. but it helps the relationship in the long run.
For sure. Yep. And so, you know, minding that boundary. So when they're at your threshold, you don't let them cross it. And you say, I'm really sorry. Wish you would have called. We're not up for guests. Let's plan something later this week. And then you shut the door.
It is going to be weird at first, but
it's going to be weird.
You only have to do it maybe once or twice.
You have to stop giving them the reward. They're still coming into your house. If they are still doing it, that means you're not minding your boundary. That means they're getting the reward. They're still coming in, getting whatever they wanted from their visit. You got to meet them at the door, not let them in.
All right, let's get into another boundary question here. How do I deal with a mother-in-law who feels like we shouldn't have any boundaries with her and we're only setting boundaries to control her?
Oh, this is such a common mistaken belief that boundaries equate to control. Absolutely.
Yes, and I'm really glad you said that because it really is one of the most common misconceptions about boundaries is that they're meant to control.
And I think it's a good time just to share my own personal like definition for a boundary. So like a boundary to me, it keeps me safe. And that's like mentally, physically, emotionally, but also it balances me out. So it allows me to live a life that is aligned with my values. So it supports my lifestyle and boundaries strengthen my relationships. And in no way in that definition am I using a boundary to control another human being. And so I think part of it is just accepting the fact that not everyone's going to like your boundaries. And typically the people that really push back hard and they don't respect your boundaries, typically those are the takers in our lives. And we all have them. Everybody has a taker in their life. And they're the ones that we have to be consistent with our boundaries and hold our boundaries with.
Yeah, that was extremely well said. And as far as like helping her understand that this isn't about control, because it is, you know, that common misconception, I think it does come back to like, you have to actually tell her why you're setting the boundary, how it helps the relationship, like getting her on a, like a more educated page on what boundaries are all about.
I love how you keep bringing it back to helping the other party, like your loved one, understand what you're doing. And I just think that's so compassionate.
I think you should be setting the boundary. You're telling them what the boundary is, but then you're explaining to them like why this is good for us, why this prevents me resenting you, and why, like, in the end, this honestly is better for both of us.
Absolutely. And I think that's a key thing because we never, you know, just going back to the guilt question.
Yeah.
I think it's so important to remember that guilt is fleeting, that discomfort is fleeting. But when resentment starts bleeding into your relationships, it will break it down. Like, even the best, strongest relationships will get broken down and just eroded by resentment. So you do not want to keep you want to keep that feeling at bay. And that's what boundaries help with, like keeping resentment at bay.
Yeah, that's a super good point. Guilt, discomfort, those things are temporary, but resentment lingers. And I would say it builds, it compounds over time.
All right. Do you have another boundary question for us?
I do actually.
Okay.
All right. Toxic in-laws with no boundaries. I block them from calling or texting my son, but I'm wondering, is this fair or not fair?
Well, if I define somebody as unhealthy and they have unhealthy behaviors and they're probably spreading unhealthy messages, they're not going to have a direct line to my child.
Yeah, I would change this a little bit because it doesn't even matter like if they're in-laws. It's just, let's just replace in-laws with toxic adult with no boundaries. I block them from calling or texting. Is this fair or not fair?
It doesn't matter if it's fair or not fair. You're being a parent. You're protecting your child.
Again, it just comes down to you have a toxic adult. Would you want that toxic adult having a direct line to your child? Period.
This is what I love about you. The way that you approach boundaries and just situations in our life, it's always so logical and you help me pull the emotion away from it. No, I'm serious. Like, because as soon as you read the question, I just start to get pulled like, oh my gosh, could you imagine, you know, just cutting off your parent from your child? Like, so I start infusing it with my own emotions. And I love how you've always done that in our life. You just are able to break it down into like just the fundamentals. Toxic adult, streamlined access to our child, yes or no? No.
Right. Because to me, like bluntly, I mean, honestly, a toxic adult with a direct line to my child, I stop that from happening. It's completely fair.
You look good. I look kind of yellow. I don't know why.
Because you got that light on, probably.
Okay.
Turn that light off.
No. I like light.
All right, next question. Mother-in-law spanks your 12-month-old. That's important, without asking. We have never spanked our child. So I'm going to jump into this one. Okay. Right off the bat, like I said, 12-month-old is important. Obviously, just like child in general, but to me personally, like in my mind, we're talking about a baby here. I mean, 12 months old, right? 1 year old. Honestly, I would instantly intervene. It's a mother-in-law. It's a relative, but it's also my child. And I just saw them get hit, you know, spanked, hit, whatever. I think it's a little harsh. Like they can't even make decisions on their own. And so I would have to step in and I would just have to say, yeah, you know, we're not going to do that. We don't do that. You're not going to do that either. Mm-hmm. That's just not cool with me as a parent.
So for me, some questions are popping up. Like, is the mother-in-law fully aware that like spanking is out of the question? Because I would have a clear conversation with her.
Was this her norm in her own family?
Her growing up, but then also raising her own children. Was that her form of punishment and consequences? Probably, but you really do have to have a clear like communication. You have to say, so if they haven't already, they have to actually sit down and just say, Doris, we do not hit as a form of punishment. Like that is not what we're doing. Instead, this is what we're doing. And we need you to follow suit so that we can trust like the safety of our child with you when he or she is alone. Make sure she understands because she might not even know. Like they might not have even told her spanking's out of the question. Share with her, this is what we do when we have to like give a consequence. Yeah.
Like you just showed your strength there. You know, you thought about what she was thinking. Maybe it was normal to her. Whereas I'm like, hey, you're not doing that. There's no more discussion. But that's not the greatest way to do it. And that's why, like, that's why we're doing this, so everybody can learn, you know, a better way to set the boundary and keep things civil and comfortable afterwards.
Right. And that's, and I think it's a really good balance because you're just like a laser. You just cut right to the point. And then I was always too much feelings though. Like I always had, I could talk myself out of anything I needed and you would always just go laser it right to the point. And I was just too much of a mush baby. And so having both sides just kind of equaling this out is super helpful. I love that we're doing this.
Yeah, you would be too soft. I would be too hard. I would get myself in trouble that way. Because that doesn't come off well.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, if you don't have, like, let's say this is happening to you and you don't have like a partner, you know, you don't have a husband or wife. It's good that we talk about this because you have to be both sides in your head and you have to like get to that point where if you're the person that's me, where you're more hard and blunt and that's it. Or if you're the person like you, where you're too soft, you have to learn how to mesh those two as you set the boundary and your relationships are going to be a lot better because of it.
Yeah. Yeah. You're like supporting the relationship while you're doing it.
Yeah.
I think we should share a really good example of this. Like a real life example for us was with your mom, like when we were first starting out in the townhouse, and we just had like zero money. We were so broke and she wanted to help in any way, shape or form. And so every time, and sometimes it would be two times a week, she would come and visit and she would bring, you know, when you're at a grocery store, you can do paper or plastic. She would bring bags of paper bags full of sleepers, toys, canned green beans, like random food and crackers out of her cupboard, like anything she could do to help us. She would every single time.
Which and is great, but a lot of those things you don't use right away.
So right.
They stack up and they build up and you only have a certain amount of space.
Right. We were completely overflowed. I mean, like our townhouse was so weird in that we didn't have a basement. The closet we had was only in our bedrooms. We didn't even have a bathroom storage closet. We didn't have a laundry room storage closet. There was zero storage in this house. Zero. And you were using the garage as a training studio, so we didn't have that as storage. So we were very limited on what we could bring in the house. And no matter how much we communicated to her that it was so limited, it wasn't going well. So some of the things you were doing would come across as pretty harsh. You know, like you would put the bags back in her car.
Like you said, the hard approach.
Yeah. But I started to see like, okay, because we would start to bicker because we were so stressed out because of all the stuff.
Yeah. I mean, you know, resentment was building. It was adding stress.
It was so awful. And we tried everything. So it wasn't just like putting the bags back in the car. You tried to talk to her. You tried multiple things, but her love language was gifts and helping. And so then after a long struggle, that's when I came in on the other side and I was like, look, I understand you just want to help us. That's all you're trying to do and show us love because you know we're broke. But we are so stressed out and we're fighting. This is actually causing like more harm than good, like with your relationship with Ryan, plus just with us because we're overwhelmed in the house now.
Like just the level of giving was just too much.
It was. It was too much. The
level, you know?
It was. And so then I just told her if we could come to this agreement that I would tell her whenever the kids needed anything, if they were ready for a new toy, all the way to winter boots, to winter clothing, if they needed anything substantial that would cost us money, money that we didn't have, I promised her that I would tell her and that she would then be able to provide for us like what we needed. And that was it.
I mean, actually we still like that. That was like, you know, 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And actually we still do that now.
Yeah.
And it still works great. Like, you know, there's certain times of the year that she takes each kid shopping, but every time we see them, they don't come with an inventory.
An inventory.
Oh, because again, we won't be able to do that now. It would still be continuing. We would still hate it.
Yeah.
But now it's so much better. And there's that compromise because you took this, the softer approach.
Yeah. And we both worked together on it. When we knew there was a problem, the laser, you pointed it out. And then I just came in with just kind of like working with her because I could see that she just wanted to help us. But speaking of 15 years, it turned into a beautiful tradition because now they do this every year, at least twice a year, where the kids get to go and experience like Walt Disney, you know, at the Mall of America with your mom. So it's just, it's really cool how they get to spend quality time and then get what they want, like stuff we would never buy. I just wanted to share that example.
Awesome.
Yeah.
James needs a ride. So, we're about an hour. So I think we're good.
So this has been really fun. Ryan, do you think you would do this with me again? Because this is kind of fun.
I think I would. You know, so far I've just lived in the MYB DMs and done that. I know that some of you guys have talked to me as the assistant.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, I would definitely do this again.
I would love it. Cause so many people ask me, what books have you read? And honestly, it comes from you. Cause I wasn't good at boundaries until my 30s, and really it's you. And then when I went into graduate school and my professors were like, if you don't have boundaries, like all of this schooling is going to be for nothing. And it's just going to be a waste of money because you're going to burn out right away. So it was just like those two things married together. But like you have been like 70% of me figuring this stuff out. So it's awesome to actually have you like in dialogue and converse back and forth. I think it's really helpful.
Yeah. I mean, together we're just the softened laser.
Softened laser. Oh my gosh. I love that. You're so good.
The gentle laser. It's a gentle laser approach.
The gentle laser. Oh my God. You're adorable. Okay. Let's go get our son. Thank you so much for this.
Thank you.
All right. Bye.
Bye.